If he's been good to you and you're not ashamed to let the world know, come on, give God some praise in this place. Hallelujah. This indeed is the day the Lord hath made. We choose to rejoice and to be exceedingly glad in it. Has God been good to anybody in here? Bless his name. It's just another day that the Lord has kept us. And I don't know about y'all, but I'm so glad about it. Amen. You may claim your seats in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. We're grateful and we're glad and thankful that we have been privileged by the goodness of God to be able to gather again in his presence. Listen, we're not here because we're lucky. We're here because God is faithful, even when we're not. Amen. And as a consequence of all that God has done for us each and every day, each and every minute of each day, all that God had to do just to secure your spot here today, for that you ought to be grateful and appreciative for the gift of another day. Amen, somebody. And so we greet you in the name of our Lord, and we're thankful for each of you, and then even for those who are virtually sharing with us. God has smiled on each and every one of us. I'm looking at some blessed folk in this place, and even if you don't feel like it, even if you don't think you are, I'm trying to tell you, you're favored by the hand of God, and we ought to be grateful for that. And so we've come to worship the Lord today. And I want us to get in the mindset of worship. I want us to set our affections on things that are above. I want you to get your mind off of your bills. Get your mind off of your troubles. Get your mind off of your enemies. Get your mind off of your haters. Get your mind off of that job that's stressing you out. And I want you to fix your attention on the Lord even now, because we've come to and have an encounter with the Lord. Anybody came to have an encounter with the Lord today? Yeah, so we want to prepare our hearts. We want to present ourselves unto the Lord even now as a living sacrifice, even now. Come on, just say, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Come on, prepare your hearts. Come on, say that with us.
Lord, prepare me.
Come on.
To be a sanctuary.
Come on, church. Come on. Pure
and holy.
Tried and true.
Tried and true.
Sing it, go.
To be a sanctuary.
praise, give him praise. That's what we've come to do. That's what we've come to do. Allow the Lord to have his way even now. Hallelujah. Our praise team is coming to lead us further in worship. And we have a guest psalmist who's come to lead us and help us today. Miss Alexius, who's coming. Come on, praise God for our praise team as they come even now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is anybody glad that you're changed this morning?
Yes, God. Thank
you. Hallelujah. You're not the same person that you once were.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Silence.
Yes, Lord.
A change.
Yes.
A change has come over me. Just to do.
Change. I said, anybody thankful for the change? Hallelujah. Fact is, I know I'm not where I should be. I even know that I'm not where I could be. But I'm still going to shout because I thank God I'm not where I used to be. He's made a change. Hallelujah. I'll say it again. He made a change in my life. Hallelujah. As a matter of fact, you shouldn't just shout about your change, but the folk around you ought to thank God you've been changed. Matter of fact, won't you just find, look at somebody and tell them, you better thank God I've been changed. You better thank them. Mm-hmm. Woo, because if you knew me back in the day, Lord have mercy, I was a mess. But look what the Lord has done. And for that, we're thankful. Father, thank you for the change, the transformation that you've worked in our lives from the inside out, each and every day of our lives. We sense you working to sanctify us, to make us and mold us to become more and more like Jesus. Now, God, I pray now as I stand, I need you to anoint me afresh. I pray that even as I proclaim your word, they will not see Kelly, but they will see Jesus Christ. Him crucified and raised on the third day. We need to hear from heaven. So, Lord, I pray now for my brothers, my sisters who are waiting, wondering if is there a word from the Lord. I pray as you speak that they would have sensitive ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. I pray that this word today will yield a harvest that will cause us to forever never be the same. God, would you get glory? And we ask it in Jesus' name. And the people of God said amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, get your Bibles and meet me in an Old Testament passage that's found in the book of 2 Samuel chapter 12. If you've been tuning in to our Bible studies, you know that we are in a series entitled Better Together on Wednesday nights. And this past week, I shared a word entitled Admonish One Another. Admonish one another. That means to teach, to exhort, to correct, to confront one another. I could not shake that word. And whenever God allows a word to literally become heavy on me, that means I'm not supposed to move on. That I'm supposed to stick and stay. Because there's more that he wants to say. And there's a greater need for that word. So I'm going to be obedient today. And I want to look at this text that I believe illustrates the point. And I want to preach a challenging word today from 2 Samuel chapter 12. I'm reading from the New King James Version. And here's how my Bible reads. It says, "Then the Lord sent Nathan to David. And he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom. It was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. So David's anger was greatly aroused against the man. And said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die. And he shall restore fourfold for the lamb because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel and delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping. And gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I also would have given you much more. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? You have killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword. You have taken his wife to be your wife and have killed him with the sword of the people of Ammon. Therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you from your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel, before the son. So David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. I want to tag this text, the ministry of correction. The ministry of correction. Ladies and gentlemen, our text comes on the heels of the darkest moment and the greatest failure in David's life. After reaching the pinnacle of success and leading the nation into peace, prosperity, and power, David succumbed to sin. And although he was able to overcome a giant by the name of Goliath, he was not able to overcome a giant named lust. He committed adultery with a woman named Bathsheba and got her pregnant. And then in an effort to cover up that sin, David had her husband Uriah put on the front line of battle to be killed. After Uriah's death, he then took Bathsheba as his wife, and he thought they would live happily ever after. But chapter 11 closes by saying that what David had done displeased the Lord. Now in chapter 12, an entire calendar year had passed, and David had done nothing to address his sinful behavior. No acknowledgement of sin. No confession of sin. No repentance for his sin. No sign of contrition for his sin. David spent an entire year covering and concealing his sin. He was distant and disconnected from God. But this text teaches us that when we won't go to God about our sin, God will confront us about our sin. Go on, preach, Pastor Kelly. When we won't address our sin, God will address our sin his way and in his time. And in chapter 12, God confronted David about his sin in the personage of the prophet Nathan. This was not the first time that God sent Nathan to David with a word. The last time was in 2 Samuel chapter 7 concerning David's aspiration to build God a temple. Nathan had a word from God, and God told David that it was not God's will for him to build him a temple. However, God made a covenant with him. God said, I will raise up your offspring, and your son will build me a temple. And God promised him that the kingdom would remain in his family forever. This was a covenant pointing to Jesus Christ. Here it is. Nathan went to David in chapter 7 with a word pertaining to a covenant. But now here in chapter 12, he's not coming with the word of a covenant. He's now coming with a word of correction. This encounter changed the very course of David's life. It is through this confrontation we get to see what tough love is all about. Nathan shows us that the real evidence of love is not how you treat people when they succeed, but how do you treat people when they mess up and fall into sin. It's not about how you handle their high seasons, but how do you handle them stumbling into low season. Nathan shows us that when people mess up and experience failure, they don't always need tender love. Sometimes some folk need them to shake them up with some tough love. And Nathan was assigned to go to David, not to coddle him, but to confront him, not to condone his sin, but to challenge him to repent of his sin. And Nathan is the unsung hero in David's life that helped him recover from a major mistake. As a matter of fact, it's because of Nathan's ministry of correction that we have Psalm 51. David said, I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. It's because of Nathan that we have Psalm 32, where he said, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Can I tell you, church, that is what is needed, but yet lacking in the contemporary church. We have people who succumb to sin, who need to be corrected, but we don't have people who have matured in the word and are in a place where they have the Holy Ghost boldness to participate and occupy the ministry of
correction. And can I tell you that we cannot allow people just simply to be comfortable in sin, and we see them heading into the path of destruction, and yet it doesn't bother us. Something ought to stir you to want to help somebody to change the course of their life, realizing that just one word can transform the direction of their lives. We have to take this seriously, because when God instructed Ezekiel, he told Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 18, he says, when I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, and you give him no warning, nor speak to warn the wicked from his wicked ways to save his life, that same wicked man shall die in his iniquity. But hear me, church, God says, but his blood I will require at your hand. And we got many people in church walking around with bloody hands, because we fail to speak words of correction, and we fail to help people come out from their sins. There are those who don't want to be a part of that ministry, but then there are also those who don't want to receive correction. They don't want nobody telling them anything. They want to come, have good church, sit in their seat, and go on about their lives and live any kind of way. The fact is, we all need some correction. There are those who don't like correction and claim those who try to help are being too judgmental. But it has been said that correction is only seen as judgment to those who still love their sin. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 1 says this: whoever loves discipline loves knowledge, but he who hates reproof is stupid. I believe that if we're going to get to the place of healing, wholeness, and restoration, we need both those who begin to fulfill the ministry of correction and be willing to receive correction. Here's what I stood to say today. Let me just cut to the chase. Here's my sermon focus, and that is God sovereignly assigned mature believers to engage those who have fallen into sin, to lead them to repentance and restoration. God sovereignly assigned mature believers to engage those who have fallen into sin, to lead them to repentance and restoration. I want to look at this ministry of correction, because I believe there's some other Davids in this room. There are some Davids that are going to cross your path, and I want to help you be able to occupy the ministry of correction. So what are the requirements? I'm glad you asked. Y'all asking good questions this morning. There are three requirements in this text. Here's the first requirement. The first requirement is divine authorization. That's the first requirement. Divine authorization. Nathan didn't just go off the rails and confront David on his own. The text says this: God sent Nathan to David. Nathan had been authorized by God. I share with you Wednesday, we all have a responsibility as a part of the body of Christ to admonish one another, to teach one another, to exhort one another, to confront one another, to correct one another. But before you do it, you have to make sure you follow the proper protocol. You notice a pilot has the authority to fly a plane, but when it gets on the runway, even though they have authority over the plane, the pilot just can't take off. They first have to get clearance from the control tower. I don't care how skilled they are. I don't care how much experience they have. I don't care how good the weather is. I don't care even if the runway is clear. The pilot have to sit on the runway until they receive clearance from the control tower. Can I tell you that as a child of God, regardless of how seasoned you are or mature you are or how long you've been saved or how much Bible you know, I'm trying to tell you, you cannot operate in the ministry of correction until God gives you clearance. It requires authorization. And so this is what you need to know. Write this down. Authorization must be clarified through prayer. Get that, church? Authorization must be clarified through prayer. Listen again, verse 1. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, which implies that Nathan was in tune with God. It implies that Nathan talked to God. That means that Nathan had a prayer life, and Nathan was clear about his assignment because he spent time with God. I'm sure David's business was already in the streets. I know by now, after a year, the street committee had already got hold of it. And everybody was talking about David, his new wife, her husband being dead. You know that everybody knew. But nobody was saying anything to David. But notice, Nathan doesn't operate based on what he heard in the streets. Nathan goes to God and prays to God to get clarity from God to know how to move forward, because sometimes we move too fast and don't have all the details because we're listening to the street and not going to the Savior. Notice he didn't move until he heard from God, because the ministry of correction is not based on a person's feeling. You've ever heard folks say, I just felt like I needed to say something. Or listen, it's not based on your opinion. Folks say, I just need to tell them what I thought about it. Hear me. It's based on the Spirit of God leading you to help somebody. And it must be confirmed in prayer. You gotta get clarity in prayer. But then, wait a minute, authorization demands humility. You're going to get this authorization, it demands, once you get clearance, it demands humility. Listen, when God gives you clearance, you must make sure you clothe yourself in humility. Can't just go to somebody with a superiority complex, thinking you are better than they are because you know their sin. You can't go to somebody looking down on them because they've fallen into sin. You have to look at someone else's sin so that it can heighten your awareness about your own sin. The Bible says, ye who thinks he stands, take heed lest he fall, because, hear me, it could have been you. So that's why you should view other folks' faults not from the vantage point of looking out a window, but from the vantage point of looking in a mirror, because the difference is simply the grace of God. Or, scoot up, church, you just ain't got caught yet. And the fact is, we have to have humility, but then also authorization demands compassion. Compassion. The point of correction, church, is not exposure. The point of correction is restoration. The point is not for me to highlight someone's sin to the world, but the point is to help somebody come out from their sin. And it takes compassion and love. That's why the Bible says love covers a multitude of sin.
when I love somebody, I'm not going to condone your sin, but I'm going to cover you. I know how to correct you and cover you at the same time. I know how to check you, but at the same time, hold you up. Because that's what love does. And we see that in the text, because watch what the text says again. It says, God sent Nathan to David. Notice, Nathan did not make a pit stop. Nathan didn't go discuss David's business with anybody else. Because when you care about somebody, you don't put their business in the streets. You want to protect them, and you only want to address the person in whom God has sent you to. And the reason why I believe there's so much hurt and distrust in the church is because too many times people allowed themselves to become vulnerable and shared their hurts and shared their secrets and shared their sorrows, only to have somebody who claims to be a sanctified saint to go out and spread their business in the street, and now they have lost their trust in the church. Because when you love, you ain't gonna try to bring pain to somebody. You're gonna try to cover somebody with compassion. But then authorization also demands courage. Remember who Nathan is confronting: the king. He's confronting someone who has the authority to kill him, imprison him, or even excommunicate him. By Nathan confronting him, he was risking his life, his freedom, and his vocation. Nathan was in a privileged position being the king's advisor, and he could have easily played it safe by remaining silent and acting like most folk who are in the church sometime, like they don't see anything. But Nathan loved God and David too much to stick by and say nothing. Nathan reveals what true love is all about by having the courage to confront David. And listen, we need more folk who have courage. See, the reason why I believe David fell into sin is because David had people around him who had no integrity and who had no courage. He had people around him who were enablers and who were yes people, that when he wanted to do something, whether it was right or wrong, they did it anyway and allowed David to feel comfortable about his sin. But Nathan said, I am not somebody who can just sit by, allow you to wallow in sin, and don't say anything. And I believe that's the problem, because the Bible says faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. And the problem is, we like people kissing up to us, but they don't realize the kisses are really deceitful. And sometimes you need somebody that loves you enough to hurt you in order to help you, rather than risk the relationship. They will say what you need to hear, even if you don't want to hear it. Courage. Divine authorization. But then here's the second requirement. It's not just divine authorization, but secondly, second requirement is a delicate approach. A delicate approach. Authorization doesn't mean anything if you don't have the right approach. Hear me, church. Sometimes it's not what you say, it's how you say it. Now, y'all want to act like that today, so let me go and go there with you. You've messed up. No, don't act like that. You've messed up. You ain't fooling me. We've all messed up. And you know it ain't. You know what you did. But you don't want folk to come to you any kind of way about what you did. If you are going to approach me, it's already a sensitive subject matter. You better make sure you step to me the right kind of way. Because if you step to me crazy, I'm going to respond in the same spirit you stepped. Y'all ain't, I wish I had some real folk in here.
Here's what Thomas Edison said. Thomas Edison said, he said, a good intention with a bad approach often get a negative result. Because it's all about the approach. My favorite sitcom of all time is The Cosby Show. I grew up loving The Cosby Show. Still do, and I, even with the scandal and them pulling it from syndication, thank God it's coming back. If I see it, I'm going to watch it. I just love it. And one of my favorite episodes is from the final season. It's the episode where Vanessa comes home from college. And when she comes home from college, she comes with a surprise. She brings a male friend who is much older than she is, who is a maintenance worker at her university. She comes with this friend named Dabness and informed the family that they were engaged and that they plan to be married in 1 year. Mr. and Mrs. Huxtable were not delighted. They were actually disgusted. Dabness tried to smooth things over by saying, listen, I love Nessa. I'm going to take care of her. I'm from a good family. I'm a good man. But Dr. Huxtable stopped him. He said, I don't mean no harm, but I got to be honest with you. We don't like you. And he said, it's not because of your vocation. You could have been a banker, and we still wouldn't like you. He says, the person to blame for us not liking you is Vanessa. He said, Dabness, what do you have a favorite food? He said, yes. What's your favorite food? He said, I love a steak. He said, all right, love a steak. How do you like it? You like with all the trimmings? He said, yes, I like mushrooms on my steak. He said, oh, okay. And what side would you like with your steak? He said, oh, I love some fried potatoes. He said, all right, good. So say if I were to make you a porterhouse steak, and I prepared that porterhouse steak the way you loved it, and I topped it off with some mushrooms and all of that, and I also prepared some fried potatoes the way you like it, that when you smelt it, it made your mouth water. And once I prepared it, what if I were to take your favorite meal that you love and you can smell the aroma, and take the lid of a trash can and put the steak and the potatoes on the lid of a trash can and then present it to you? Wouldn't be too advertising, would it? He said, that's the way Vanessa presented you to us. The reason why we can't receive you is because she presented you on the lid of a trash can. You know the reason why some folk can't receive correction from you? It's because your approach is like a lid of a trash can. The reason why some folk can't receive other folk is because their attitude is like the lid of a trash can. It's all in the approach. And Nathan realized he had to be delicate in how he approached David. David was already paranoid. David was already depressed. He not only committed adultery, he had already committed murder. So he had to handle it in a delicate way, and I like the way Nathan confronted him, approached him. He actually made David the judge and jury. He tells a story. He says, listen, David, there were two men. One was rich and one was poor. The rich man had an abundance of flock and herd, but this poor man only had one little ewe lamb. He loved that ewe lamb. He allowed it to eat from its table, allowed him to drink from his own cup. He even held it in his bosom. It grew up like it was his own daughter. One day, the rich man had a traveler coming in unexpectedly, and you know the custom is you have to feed your guests. And instead of taking from his own flock or his own herd, he took the one ewe lamb from the poor man and fed it to the traveler. And David, being a shepherd, knew the connection between a shepherd and his sheep. David was furious, and this is what he said. Said, that man shall surely die. Not only that, he says, he will restore the poor man fourfold for all the pain he'd caused him. And this is what simply Nathan said. You the man. That's what he said. David, it's you. Notice, conviction did not occur until Nathan caused David to see his sin from a different perspective. Because y'all, we are quick to judge someone else's sin, but we are slowful in looking at our own sin. And the moment Nathan highlighted someone else's sin, David went quick to judgment and said he deserved to die. And here's what Nathan said: you've just sentenced yourself. It's the approach. And sometimes, y'all, we can't get to the place of correction. We can't get to the place of conviction because our approach is not right. But wait a minute, it's not just a delicate approach. But then finally, third requirement is a declaration for accountability. A declaration for accountability. Because his approach was delicate, but Nathan's message was not. Nathan made sure that David knew the seriousness of his sin. I like it because Nathan didn't sugarcoat the word. He didn't try to make David feel comfortable or accommodate his feelings. He spoke God's word directly to him. Can I just let Nathan preach for himself? This is what Nathan said. Nathan said to David, you are the man. Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel. I deliver you out of the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house, your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. Here's the line, y'all. And if this were too little, I would add to you as much more. Nathan said, God said, God has given you everything a man could ever want or desire. You already had everything. And if you desired something else, God said all you had to do was ask, and I wouldn't have withheld it from you. I would have given you so much more. But you have cut your own self short because you decided to take matters into your own hands and try to live your own way rather than just trusting the hand of God, the same God that elevated you, the same God that appointed you, the same God that anointed you, the same God that blessed you and prospered you and protected you. And now you got to the place you've been longing for. Now you disregard God and take what he's given you for granted, and now you want to step outside the boundaries and sin against God when God says no good thing would I withhold from you. He said God loved you so much he would have given you so much more, but you chose your flesh over the Spirit of God. Then wait a minute, he says, and here's what you need to know, and I'm done, church. Your sin has consequences. And God is going to hold you accountable for your sins. I gotta let Nathan preach it. Here it is. He can preach for himself. Verse 10, he says, now for the sword shall never depart from your house. Because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife, thus says the Lord. Behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. Here's the word. The baby that Bathsheba's carrying, that baby's going to die. Your son Amnon is going to rape your daughter Tamar. Your other son Absalom is going to kill your son Amnon. Your son Absalom is going to turn on you, lead an insurrection, trying to take your throne. That everything that you've done to others now, it's getting ready to come back to you, but it's going to come back to you in your own house. There are going to be consequences. And y'all, here's the line, verse 12, watch this. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel, before the sun. This is what God said. Your sin took place in private. But God said, I will make sure your punishment will be made public. Your sin took place behind the scenes, but your punishment will be played out on the stage. Your sin took place in the DM, but your punishment will be displayed on the timeline. Your sin took place in the dark, but God said, I'm going to chasten you in the light. God says, listen, I know you were sneaky, but God said, I ain't sneaky. It will be televised. But there's good news. Here's the good news. Verse 13 says, David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Y'all don't run past that. It's been a year, and he never uttered those words. It's been a year. He never acknowledged it. It's been a year. He never took responsibility. It's been a year, and he's never not once tried to repent. It wasn't until Nathan confronted him and corrected him, and through the correction, it led to him saying, I have sinned. Not blaming nobody else, not making excuses. I have sinned. Sin, and y'all, I'm simply trying to help somebody understand it's through the ministry of correction that we can help people get to the place of repentance and experience restoration. But when we fail to walk in our purpose, we allow people to go astray. Here's the word from the Lord. Because of his confession, the Lord also said, he says, you're not going to die. I'm not going to give you what you said you deserve. You said the man deserved death. I'm not going to kill you. And the Lord said, I have put away your sin. God says, you're going to go through some consequences. But God says, I'm going to take your sin, and I'm going to cover your sin like it never happened. I'm going to remove your sin far away from you as far as the east is from the west. And I will remember your sin no more. God says, when I forgive you and I release you and cleanse you, it doesn't come back up against you. When I went to college, my mother bought me a word processor. Some of you young folk don't know what a word processor is. We have them these computers now, near like we do now. My mom gave me a word processor so that I would be able to type papers in college. And I wasn't that skilled in typing. I'd only had a little class in high school. And back then, if you were typing a paper, you wanted to make sure you didn't make mistakes. Because you can be almost at the end of the page and you mess up real bad. It could cause you to have to start all over again. And y'all, so that's why I was cautious. I would type with two fingers to make sure I got it right. But then I came across something called correction tape. I wonder, does anybody know anything about correction tape? And what happened with correction tape, it changed my life. Because with correction tape, I did not have to take the paper out and start all over again because I made a mistake on the page. What all I had to do was take the strip of correction tape and cover the mistake and type in the word that I intended to say on the page. And watch this, the correction tape didn't just cover the mistake, But what the correction tape did, it gave me a brand new start. See, that's what God does. That when we fall into sin, when we confess our sin, when we repent of our sin, God has some correction tape called grace and mercy. God has some correction tape called the blood of Jesus that not only covers our sin, but gives us a brand new start. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. Is there anybody here thank God for a brand new start in the Lord Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. Every person standing, thank God for the ministry of correction. Father, I did my best to be faithful to the assignment you gave me. I know it's a challenging word for us to operate within the ministry of correction. Sometimes we're fearful of rejection. Sometimes we're fearful of people's opinion. But God, I pray that we would be led by your Holy Spirit. That wherever we can be a help, whenever we can be a blessing to someone, that sometimes, even when it's tough, that we will have the courage, the humility, the compassion to help somebody. We want to be better for you. We want our brother and our sister in Christ to be better for you. So help us even now. Now, God, I pray that even maybe under the sound of my voice, somebody needs correction. Somebody needs salvation. Somebody needs to be restored. You move by your spirit in this place even now. Have your way. In Jesus' name. And the people of God said amen and amen. If you receive that word today, come on, give God praise for his word. Listen, there might be someone here who doesn't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We want to make sure you have an opportunity to say yes. The Bible teaches us that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised his son from the dead, you shall be saved. If you need a church home, a church family, listen, we would love to be your family. You just have to make that decision, that choice. As you can see on the screen, there's our church website, Beulahland.org, Beulahland.org. If you go into Beulahland.org, there's a link called Join. You have the option to do so, but just simply putting your information in, you can accept Jesus Christ, you can become a member of this church. And when you do that and submit that, somebody's going to be in contact with you to welcome you, to pray with you, to lead you to Christ. And celebrate the change that's come in your life. You can do that even right now. In Jesus' name. Amen, somebody. Come on, give God praise one more time. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, we're preparing to bring our tithes and offerings unto the Lord. And amen, at this time, let's ready our hearts to do so. If you are giving virtually, utilize any of our platforms, we encourage you to do so. Text to give, website, or even through RAM, we encourage you to do so. And if you're giving the traditional way, we do have envelopes available. If you want to give the traditional way, you can do so. Just let our ushers know you need an envelope. If you're giving via cash or check, you can do it that way even now. Amen. Amen. Let's be faithful in our giving unto the Lord. Amen. At this time, let's prepare to receive our Beulahland Action News.
Greetings, Beulahland Bible Church family and friends. Welcome to another edition of Beulahland Action News. We've resumed our Sunday morning in-person worship services, and we want you to be a part. To register, visit our website at www.beulahland.org and click on the in-person registration tab to sign up for the service of your choice. The registration window is from Monday at 12 a.m. until Thursday at 11:59 p.m. We are still observing protocols to keep all of our members and visitors safe. It's an ever-evolving process, and we do appreciate your patience with our staff and volunteers as we navigate through this re-entry season. Continue to be prayerful as renovation in the North Campus continues. Our main goal is for the task to be completed in excellence and for God to be glorified. The mission of Beulah Land Bible Church is changing lives from Middle Georgia by connecting people to Christ and the church, growing people in the Word to Christ-like maturity, serve others with our spiritual gifts, and go reach the world for Christ. Thank you for listening to Beulah Land Action News. Beulah Land, it is now time to give. We have several options available for giving. Give using one of our mobile apps. The Secure Give app and the Givelify app make it easy and safe to give. Simply download the app from your device's app store and follow the prompts. You also have the option of giving using text to give. Simply text GIVE BBC to 73256, then follow the link to give. Giving via text is quick and safe. Give using our website at www.beulahland.org. Click on the Giving tab and follow the prompts. If you're registered for Realm, you can also give through the Realm Connect app. If you aren't on Realm, use the link tinyurl.com/bbcrealm for instructions on signing up. Finally, you can give by mail. Seal your gift in an envelope and mail to the church at 1010 Newburgh Avenue, Macon, Georgia, 31206. Beulah Land, let's continue to be committed to God through our giving. Now, let us continue in worship.
Amen. Let's govern ourselves according to all of our announcements. I want to remind you again that we'll be having baby dedication on the second Sunday of next month, which is September the 12th. And so if you have a baby that you want to be dedicated back to the Lord, all you need to do is call our church office so that you can be included again on the second Sunday in September. Amen. You can do so. Amen. Also, continue to pray. I know we were able, by the grace of God, and we still have some work to do here at our South Campus, but we partially completed the renovation here at our South Campus, and I pray that you love what you have witnessed thus far. Amen. And it's been a blessing. But also, I pray that you are in prayer with us for the renovation that's going on at the North Campus, as that's taking place even now. This was a major undertaking, but God has proven himself to be faithful. Amen. And so we're just excited about what the Lord is doing. Don't forget prayer call on Tuesday. It's been powerful. God's been moving and blessing. But then also Bible study virtually at 6:45 on Wednesday as we continue our series together. Wednesday, we're going to be pretty much staying in that vein. We're going to be talking about bearing one another's burdens, bearing one another's burdens. And so I hope you join in with us. Listen, let's continue to pray for all of our bereaved families. We want to remember Sister Angel Whittington in the passing of her aunt, Blanche Sneed. We want to remember Sister Jaretta Flanders and the passing of her grandmother, who was 105 years old, Lilia Bell, who passed. And then also Brother Tracy Ford in the passing of his brother Timothy Ford. And then we also want to remember Catherine Spencer in the passing of her husband, Melvin Spencer. Amen. So let's keep all of our bereaved families and those who are sick, let's keep them lifted up in our prayers. Amen. Amen. Listen, today was the first time I've had my wife in church with me in person. Amen. Amen. And she's been caring for our mother, and but she was able to come and be with us. And I after the 7:30 service, I whispered in her ear when I sat down. I said, "Church ain't church without you." Amen. It just because I know if I ain't got an amen from anybody else in here, I got an amen right there. Amen. And so it's just good to have you back. Amen. Good to have you back. Amen. Were you blessed today in worship? Listen, I really need y'all to really be in prayer. Don't know what's going on, but we are having a challenge today with technology, our streaming. Matter of fact, when service started, we were in here live, but we couldn't get it up online. And there are many of our members who are virtual still. And this is something that we've been wrestling with. And I know this is spiritual warfare. I know it's a plot and attack of the enemy. Amen. And even when I was, you know, told that, I had to just really put my mind in check and say, listen, we're just going to go, y'all record it, and we'll just post it later. But it's just something we're working diligently to make. But we know how frustrating it can be when you have those issues. But they are beyond our control. And we're really, especially with Facebook, when something go on with Facebook, ain't nobody can just say, hey, y'all, can we, you know, they don't operate like that. And so there are some things that we're having to work through. And I don't know why we have been selected as someone who attacks us. I've had people trying to claim my sermons as being their content that I wrote, the Lord gave me, or things. And when somebody makes a claim, you got to fight it. And this is on a weekly basis. Every week we leave church having to fight a claim. And so we're just being attacked. But y'all, we're believing God. There's something God is up to and doing. Amen, somebody. So that's why I'm just letting you know to be patient with us, because it's something beyond our control that, every week we are battling to make sure. And when it goes well, y'all might not be shouting, but we shouting. Amen, somebody, because we know what it takes to make it happen. So thank you so much. Listen, I'm going to cover our time in prayer, our benediction, and our giving in prayer. And then Pastor Scrugg is going to come back, and he's going to dismiss us from this place and give us an orderly dismissal. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for this time of worship. We know the enemy is plotting and planning, doing everything he can to block and stop your worship and word from going forth and getting out to the world. But we already know that we are more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. And thank you for the victory that we know has already been won. So we ain't going to worry. We ain't going to stress. We ain't going to trip. We're going to stand on your promises, God. And even now, God, I thank you for today, as you have challenged us and charged us with the ministry of correction. Help us, God, have the right mentality, have the right approach. Understand that, God, we have to be authorized by you to do so, and that when we do it, we're doing it to be a blessing to someone else, to restore them and not tear them down. I pray, God, we hide this word in our heart that we might not sin against you. Now, God, I pray that you would bless the gifts that have been sown today. Bless the giver as they have sacrificially released their tithes and offerings to you, trusting your word and believing what you said. You said, try me and see when I open up the windows of heaven and pour out of you a blessing, you will have room enough to receive. So, God, will you blow their mind? Exceed their expectations. And God, I pray that you would cover us as we leave this place. I pray that you would give us a blessed week, a week filled with good health, filled with laughter. And God, I pray that it would be our determination to live faithfully for you. And God, I pray that you would be glorified in all that we do. It's in the name of Jesus. Now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with each of us now and forevermore. Let every heart say amen and amen. God. God bless you. I love y'all. Here's a virtual hug.
Come on, put your hands.